Once again, Christian greetings to all our valued listeners and viewers throughout the whole world, more particularly to all shepherds, rod believers, and most especially to our beloved brothers and sisters in the United States of America. Good evening and may the good Lord bless you, brothers and sisters. And also to all the 144,000 living saints scattered throughout the whole world, greetings and may the good Lord bless you, brothers and sisters. This is our episode number 4 on the subject, the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. I would like to quote that sentence on volume 8, 298, saying, "We must follow the direction given through the spirit of prophecy." And track number 6, page 43, says, "Have you not yet discovered that whether it be in ancient or in modern times, all the Bible truths that men have ever learned have come only through the inspired channel, the spirit of prophecy?" And it says in answerer number 3, page 35, "Let all who share the questioner's sentiments take pause and ponder the question, how can an uninspired message be from God, be the truth, be worthy of acceptance? The acceptance of so-called Bible truth without inspiration is the devil's traps of deception." 2SR 286, "The acceptance of so-called truth without inspiration is the devil's trap of deception. And they who advocate such fallacious teachings are the hardest and most impossible ones to rescue from Satan's bottomless pit. For he makes them believe that confession of their errors would disqualify them for teachers and dishonor their high standing." Track number 15, page 31. "Plainly then, whatever things inspiration itself does not teach and interpret are not worth remembering, teaching, or even listening to." Track number 15, pages 31 and page 32. "Plainly then, whatever things inspiration itself does not teach and interpret are not worth remembering, teaching, or even listening to." Track number 1, page 44. "As you will find yourself under severe trial, if you obey your inner convictions and take hold of the truth, you must therefore let the Lord alone be your guide and inspiration your only teacher." Track number 1, page 44. Now let us study closely the subject concerning the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. And let us distinctly separate the slaughtering and the term the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. So, I would like to read 2SR, page 18. "One of the chief reasons why confusion arises among Bible students is because they do not entirely depend on the biblical expression of the words. They think themselves wiser than the prophets who were inspired with the Spirit of God and thus wish to correct the words and meaning of the Holy Bible. Hence, finite mortals have attempted to rectify and correct the Infinite One, whose wisdom, power, and vision is unsearchable. Though they know their interpretation of a text is not altogether in harmony with the whole tenor of the book and law, they see no injury and fear not God. And when the fact is revealed, they refuse to exchange error for truth because it contradicts their false theology. We invite the earnest attention of the reader upon this subject, and that he take notice of the wonderful harmony of the scriptures and the great wisdom used in them." 2SR, page 18. I remember the statement in track number 5, pages 6 and page 7. "Any explanation of a prophecy which adds to or takes from any part of relevant scripture in order to harmonize the interpretation can only be false. When the Spirit of God interprets the Scriptures, He does not in any way need to alter any part of them in order to make the explanation fit that which is being unfolded. When, moreover, the true interpretation of a prophecy is made, it always contains a lesson of present truth adapted to the necessities of God's people. Track number 5, pages 6 and page 7. So, we need to study the shepherd's rod, and we should not improvise or alter the statements that have been recorded. We need to understand just as what it reads. Here in answerer number 1, page 47, it says, inspiration makes very clear that the Lord's messenger dare not in any way improvise upon revelation, although often privileged to articulate it in his own words. So, the Lord's messenger, inspired by the Spirit of God, he will not alter, neither improvise what had been recorded. Or, to get the full beam of light, more particularly this very important subject concerning the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, we need to harmonize all other related statements according to answerer number 3, page 41, saying, let us remember always to observe the inviolable rule that an interpretation of one inspired statement must harmonize with all other related statements. Now, for example, in 3 symbolic code number 1, page 8, it says, therefore, as there are two separations, there is a double fulfillment of Ezekiel's slaughter, one in the church before the close of provision, and the other in the worldly churches after the close of provision. When everyone has made his decision, the unfaithful spiritual guardians or the false watchmen of the people are the first to fall in the worldly churches. Just as the ancient men who are in the Seventh-day Adventist church are the first to fall. This is the only explanation that will harmonize every statement on this subject found in Spirit prophecy and in the Bible. So, we need no longer to improvise this statement or alter this statement. The statement is very plain, and for a little help, brothers and sisters, we need to produce a simple illustration. This one, in the church, and the other is worldly churches, and the other one is worldly churches, according to the shepherd's rod. Now, that is very plain. It says, the slaughtering in Ezekiel 9 has a double application. So, very plain, or double fulfillment. The statement is, Ezekiel 9 has a double fulfillment, and the dividing line is the close of provision. Therefore, we need now to harmonize with all other statements in the shepherd's rod. First, who are they, the worldly churches? It's very important to understand who are they, the worldly churches, by which the wicked among them will be slaughtered after the close of provision. But the wicked in the church will be slaughtered before the close of provision. What church mentioned in that reading? So we need to study closely. What specific church? Let us place the question. What specific church? Place in the box. And in the other box, who are they? The worldly churches. And also the question, what close of provision? So, although it is already very definite, the shepherds that divided the two slaughterings, the slaughtering before the close of provision and the slaughtering after the close of provision. That is very plain here in 3 symbolic code number 1, page 8. Now, I would like to read again. Therefore, as there are two separations, there is a double fulfillment of Ezekiel's slaughter. One in the church before the close of provision, and the other in the worldly churches after the close of provision. So, very plain, right? So, our goal is to find out what close of provision mentioned there, and who are they, the worldly churches mentioned? And what specific church mentioned in that reading? Because the shepherd's rod used the definite article, the church, in the church. One in the church before the close of provision. Here's another statement that I would like to read. Old symbolic code. One symbolic code, number 15, page 9. It says, as both citations in the above must be correct, it proves that the slaughter of Ezekiel 9 takes place before the commencement of the loud cry. Let's read again. One symbolic code, number 15, page 9. As both citations in the above must be correct, it proves that the slaughter of Ezekiel 9 takes place before the commencement of the loud cry. The same truth can be proved by the Bible from several different angles. And here's another statement. It says, two symbolic code, number 7 and 8, page 11. It says, who are the slain of the Lord in the time of persecution? Are they of the heathen, of fallen Protestantism? Or are they of professed Sabbath keepers? Answer. Those who are slain before the commencement of the loud cry in fulfillment of Isaiah 66 verse 16 are professed Sabbath keepers who fail in the time of the closing work for the church to receive the seal of God. Testimonies for the Church, volume 3, page 266. However, those who are slain in fulfillment of Revelation 9 verse 18 in the time of the loud cry are those who come in close contact with the church of God and who could be either heathen or professed Christians of several characters, namely such as those who are openly war against the church and those who pretend to believe in her teachings, but as those who were destroyed in the Exodus movement are by their sins working against the church to weaken her lines of defense, thus endeavoring to cause her to fall helpless before her enemies. Two symbolic codes, 7 and 8, page 11. Now, the slaying mentioned there is Isaiah 66, verse 16, and Revelation 9, verse 18. Now, let us look at again. We produce just a simple diagram. So, let us distinctly separate those who will be slain before the loud cry and those who will be slain in the time of the loud cry. Although it did not say Ezekiel 9, but Revelation 9:18. The other one is Revelation 9:18, and the other is Isaiah 66, verse 16. But both of them are called by the Bible and the shepherd's rod as slaying. Now, I would like to read here in Old Symbolic Code. One Symbolic Code, 11 to 12, page 10. Oh, let us read. It's easy. Third, remind him of Isaiah 66, verse 16, 19, and 20. The slaying mentioned in verse 16 is to be literal. For those that shall escape of them are to be sent to all the nations to proclaim his glory and his fame. This slaughter is in the church only. For those who escape of them are God's servants, whom after the slaughter he shall send to the Gentiles. And if the slaughter is not literal, then what will they escape from? Moreover, Ezekiel saw them literally slain. Ezekiel 9 verse 7. Now, it seems that Isaiah 66 verse 16 and Ezekiel 9 verse 7 is pointing to the same description, that such slaughtering is in the church only. Now, let us read another statement here in one symbolic code, number 16, page 3. Let's read. If Jeremiah 25:31 takes place at the second coming of Christ, how can he plead with all flesh? Answer. This question is answered by Isaiah 66, verse 16. For there too is stated that he will plead with all flesh. And the September number of the code, page 7, proves that the Lord begins to plead with all flesh in the proclamation of the sealing message and the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9 in the church, and will end at the close of provision when the third angel's message shall have been proclaimed in all the world for a witness unto all nations. Therefore, by the manifestation of God's judgments and by the preaching of the message in the time of the loud cry in all the world for a witness unto all nations, he pleads with all flesh. Now, the focal point here is concerning pleading with all flesh. And the shepherd's rod made it so plain, brothers and sisters, in this reading, that the term all flesh, that is the time when the message is proclaimed in the time of the loud cry throughout the whole world. But the commencement of that pleading, according to the shepherd's rod, begin in the proclamation of the sealing message and the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9 in the church. 1 Symbolico, number 16, page 3. Thus, the pleading of the Lord is the slaughtering. Brothers and sisters, think it thoroughly. The slaughtering is an act, brothers and sisters, to set an example to the great multitude which no man could number, that if they will not respond to the pleading of the Lord, they will also suffer such destruction. And I think the statement, the Lord begin to plead with all flesh in the proclamation of the sealing message in the church, that is still provisionary time, because it is illogical that the pleading of the Lord is an act of destruction. That act of destruction is the consequence to those people who did not respond to the pleading of the Lord. I remember the statement in 2 Symbolico, number 11, page 8. Let us read. This experience will awaken them as if startled out of their dreams and will enable them to receive the power of the Spirit and to put on the beautiful garments of Christ's righteousness, which gift by the prophet's pleading, he is urging us to receive the beautiful garments. Recorded in Isaiah 52, verse 1. However, no one with prejudice and self-confidence can ever come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, let us now compare, brothers and sisters, all the statements recorded in the shepherd's rod. Now, here in track number 8, page 24. Although the marking and the slaughter, Ezekiel 9, include only the church, Judah and Israel, the hurting by the winds and the hurting by the angels, Revelation 7, include all the world. Track number 8, page 24. So in that reading, we can easily understand that the divine commission given by God to the five angels bearing slaughtering weapons, the only wicked that they will destroy must be only the wicked in the church. It does not include the wicked in the world. So here we can easily understand that the four slaughtering angels in Revelation 7 have different divine commission than the five angels in Ezekiel 9. Because the divine commission given by God to five angels bearing slaughtering weapons is to destroy the wicked only in the church. And it is opposite to the four angels in Revelation 7. Because the divine commission that was given to them is to destroy the wicked in the world. So it is very important, brothers and sisters, to study closely this prophecy. Now, I would like to read again answerer number 2, page 42 and page 43. It says, the five agents that destroy the wicked in the church are not forces of nature, but men with slaughter weapons in their hands. They are supernatural beings, not natural elements. Hence, they cannot fittingly represent earthquakes, famines, or the like. Neither can they be the seven angels with the seven last plagues, for these angels are seven in number, not five. Furthermore, they do not have slaughter weapons in their hands, but vials. Still further, the plagues fall in Babylon, Revelation 18, verse 4. Whereas the slaughter of Ezekiel 9 takes place in Judah and Israel, Ezekiel 9, verse 9. So, the argument used by B.T. Hotep in that reading, saying the seven angels are the seven last plagues are poured out by the seven angels, but Ezekiel 9 have only five angels. Now, how about the statement in track number 3, page 71? It says, the reason that the church is figuratively not Babylon is that it is called Jerusalem. Ezekiel 9, verse 4 and 8. And from among the good therein, the wicked, the tares are destroyed, taken out by the six men with the slaughter weapons. Ezekiel 9, verse 6 to 9. And then afterward, the good, the wheat are gathered in the barn, while from among the wicked in Babylon, the just, my people, are called out and gathered into the barn. And then the seven angels poured out the seven last plagues, and the remaining wicked are destroyed. Thus, in the first section of the harvest, the separation in the church, the wicked are destroyed by six men with slaughter weapons before the good are taken out. And in the second section, the separation among the churches in Babylon, the wicked are destroyed by seven angels with the seven last plagues after the good are taken out. There are therefore two separations and two fruits. The former gives the first fruits, the 144,000, whom are not defiled with women. And it says, that is, they are those whom the sealing man says find in the church of God and not in the heathen churches. And the second gives the second fruits, the great multitude from all nations, some of whom also may be undefiled with women. Heathen churches. Track number 3, page 71 and page 72. Now, this reading is very plain that in this destruction, the wicked are destroyed by six men with slaughter weapons. Brothers and sisters, and no one would say that B.T. Hotep was mistaken. First of all, I fully believe that according to 2SR page 13, it says, when God reveals truth, He is able to lead His servants in all truth and does not allow such instruments to mix His truth with error. 2SR page 13. So, since I believe the Shepherd's Rod publications are written by inspiration, and the mere fact that it is called the Rod of God, God will not allow error to mix within the Shepherd's Rod publications. And also, I fully believe, according to track number 15, page 78, let us read, from the aforementioned examples, as we already see, that the time has come for all faithful Bible students, students after saving truth, to realize that inspiration never does anything vain or careless. Its work is ever accurately constructed, always dependable at face value, and explicit beyond improvement. So, I do fully believe, since the Shepherd's Rod were written by inspiration, never does anything vain or careless. Its work is ever accurately constructed, always dependable at face value, and explicit beyond improvement. I would like to read this reading and 1SR on page 13. It says, we read in Great Controversy, page 397. The spirit of error will lead us from the truth, and the Spirit of God will lead us into the truth. What then? We answer, the Spirit and Word agree. If a man judges himself by the Word of God and find a perfect harmony through the whole world, then he must believe he has the truth. But if he finds the spirit of which he is led does not harmonize with the whole tenor of God's law or book, then let him walk carefully, lest he be caught in the snare of the devil. I will read Great Controversy. The Great Controversy, 610. I would like to read this reading. Their testimony is, we dare not tamper with God's word, dividing his holy law, calling one portion essential and another non-essential to gain the favor of the world. I would like to read again. The Great Controversy, 610. Their testimony is, we dare not tamper with God's word, dividing his holy law, calling one portion essential and another non-essential to gain the favor of the world. So, we should not tamper. Let us apply that statement in the Shepherd's Rod publications. For example, the statement in track number 3, page 71, that there are six angels who will perform the act of destruction. Six angels that will slay the wicked. For sure, six and five are not the same. So we should not tamper this statement, brothers and sisters. The only thing is that, without any doubt, the slaughtering mentioned in tract number 3, page 71, by which there are six angels to slay all the wicked, could not be the same slaughtering mentioned in answerer number 2, page 42 and 43, that there are only five angels that will destroy the wicked. Although the statement in answerer number 2, page 42 and 43, and the statement in tract number 3, page 71, the same quotation, Ezekiel chapter 9. So we need to dig deeper, not to tamper, brothers and sisters. Now let us read again 1TG number 52, page 21. It says, do you, brother, sister, actually comprehend, actually realize the crisis as outlined here? Do you see the prediction that the sealing message is to be resisted by those who foster the abominations? Are you with them? I hope not. Is there then any question that if the brethren are left ignorant of this cleansing work that God is about to do among his people, I say, if they be left ignorant of it, will they not fall in the general destruction of the wicked represented by the work of the five men bearing slaughter weapons? 1TG 52, page 21. So here the description of the slaughtering of the five angels bearing with slaughter weapons is called by the Shemperswad general destruction of the wicked. And that statement is quoted in volume 3, 267. After the closing work for the church. Now, let us read the Bible. Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 1. He cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lieth toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one among them was clothed with linen, with a writer's inkhorn by his side. And they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. Verse 3. And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub, whereupon he was, to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's inkhorn by his side. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. Now in this reading, first of all, there were seven personalities mentioned here. The six men and the glory of the God of Israel. And we know that is Jesus Christ. In verse 3 it says, and the glory of the God of Israel. But it was answered in verse 4 that it is the Lord. And the Lord said unto him, to the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's inkhorn by his side. He was commanded by Jesus Christ. Ezekiel chapter 9. Now, we need now to study closely, brothers and sisters, in this subject. To repeat again, Ezekiel 9, there are seven persons mentioned in that reading. The six men, and then the glory of the God of Israel, which is Jesus Christ. Now, the statement in tract number 3, page 71, let us read again. It says, thus, in the first section of the harvest, the separation in the church, the wicked are destroyed by six men with slaughter weapons. Therefore, the statement in Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 2, saying, and behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lieth toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand. Therefore, the statement, every man, pointing to the six men, all of them, each of them, there is a slaughter weapon in their hands. And then it says, and one man among them, meaning that even though the six men, each of them, there is a slaughter weapons in their hands, but only one man among them was clothed with linen, with the writer ink horn by his side. Only one of them. That is the only tenable conclusion, brothers and sisters, as far as the Bible and the shepherd's rod is thus concerned. Now, I would like to read to you Testimonies to Ministers 431 and 432. He who presides over his church and the destinies of nations is carrying forward the last work to be accomplished for this world. To his angels, he gives the commission to execute his judgments. Let the ministers awake. Let them take in the situation. The work of the judgment begin at the sanctuary. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lie toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one man among them was clothed with linen, with a writer ink horn by his side. And they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. Read Ezekiel 9 verse 2 to 7. The command is, slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women. But come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they begin at the ancient men which were before the house, said God, I will recompense their way upon their head. The words will soon be spoken. Go your ways and pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. One of the ministers of vengeance declares, and I heard the angel of the water say, thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and was and shalt be, because thou hast judged us. These heavenly beings, in executing the mandate of God, ask no questions, but do as they are bid. Jehovah of hosts, the Lord God Almighty, the just, the true, and the holy, has given them their work to do. With unswerving fidelity, they go forth panoplied in pure white linen, and having their breasts girded with golden girdles. And when their task is done, when the last vial of God's wrath is poured out, they return, lay their emptied vials at the feet of the Lord. And the next scene is recorded. After these things, I heard as it were the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. They sing the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. We will prove to you that the slaughtering mentioned there is the seven last plagues symbolical. Now let us go back again to our reading, brothers and sisters, and let us connect 1SR. 1SR, page 37, page 38. Now I would like to read the reading. It says, five men follow the wand. So it is pointing to the five men bearing slaughtering weapons in their hands. And the statement, five men follow the wand. The wand here is the man with the writer's ink horn by his side. Now let us read. The man with the slaughter weapons must immediately follow the one with the writer's ink horn. God must separate his people if the marking is to be of any value. And except the separation takes place, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit cannot fall in its fullness upon the people of God. And then it says, I asked the meaning of the shaking I had seen, and was shown that it would be caused by the straight testimony called forth by the counsel of the true witness to the Laodiceans. This will have its effect upon the heart of the receiver, and will lead him to exalt the standard and pour forth the straight truth. Some will not bear this straight testimony. They will rise up against it, and this is what will cause a shaking among God's people. I asked what had made this great change. An angel answered, it is the lantern, the refreshing from the presence of the Lord, the loud cry of the third angel. Early Writings, page 270 and 271. It is clear that the shaking must take place before the loud cry. So it says that it is clear that the shaking must take place before the loud cry. The men with the slaughter weapons were already slaying before the men with the writer's ink horn returned to report the matter that he had done as he was commanded. Now, ponder deeply, brothers and sisters. the statement in early writings, page 38, that the men bearing five slaughtering weapons, they were already slaying before the man with the writer acorn returned to report the matter that he has done as he was commanded. So we need to analyze closely the statement, saying that the five men bearing with slaughter weapons were already slaying. By which at the time that they were slaying the wicked, the man with the writer inkhorn did not as yet reported to Jesus Christ. The word return can be easily understood that he go back to the place where Jesus Christ was. Brothers and sisters, so, or in other words, when Jesus Christ commanded the angel with the writer inkhorn by his side to seal the 144,000 in their foreheads, Jesus Christ did not accompany him. And after the angel with the writer inkhorn by his side finished the task committed to him, the divine commission, he returned to Jesus Christ and then reported, brothers and sisters. Now, let us now study closely that event. When does the angel with the writing inkhorn reported to Jesus? And the word return, where is the place? Indicating that the place by which Jesus Christ gave the commission to the angel with the writer inkhorn, he remained to that place. And that is the reason that after the angel with the writer inkhorn by his side completely finished the commission that had been given to the angel, he returned to Jesus Christ. And now let us read the statement here in track number 1, page 20 and page 21. Two sealing reports. And behold, says Ezekiel, the man clothed with linen, which had the inkhorn by his side, reported the matter while on earth, saying, I have done as thou hast commanded me. Ezekiel 9 verse 11. Here is the first report made at the completion of the sealing in the church, the sealing of the first fruits, the 144,000. Now, let us study closely, brothers and sisters, this reading, track number 1, page 20 and page 21. The shepherd's rod made it so plain that immediately after the 144,000 are completely sealed, the man with the writer inkhorn returned to Jesus. Immediately he reported, brothers and sisters, he reported to Jesus Christ that the 144,000 are completely sealed. He reported to Jesus Christ that the commission that thou hast commanded me is finished. The 144,000 are completely sealed. But the statement in 1 SR page 38, the five men with slaughtering weapons, brothers and sisters, they were already slaying. Let's go back again to 1 SR page 38. The men with the slaughter weapons were already slaying before the man with the writer inkhorn returned to report the matter that he had done as he was commanded. I think we need to read Ezekiel 9 verse 8 and 11 because it says, see Ezekiel 9 verse 8 and 11. So let us read Ezekiel 9 verse 8 and then verse 11. Verse 8, and it came to pass while they were slaying them and I was left that I fell upon my face and cried and said, Ah, Lord God, wilt thou destroy all the residue of Israel in the pouring out of thy fury upon Jerusalem? So that is verse 8. And in verse 11 it says, and behold, the man clothed with linen, which had the inkhorn by his side, reported the matter, saying, I have done as thou hast commanded me. Now the statement in 1 SR page 38 simply indicating that verse 8 fulfilled first before verse 11. Now let us read again 1 SR page 38. The men with the slaughter weapons were already slaying before the man with the writer inkhorn returned to report the matter that he had done as he was commanded. Then it says, see Ezekiel 9 verse 8 and then verse 11. So this statement saying, see Ezekiel 9 verse 8, plainly indicating that verse 8 fulfilled first before verse 11. That in verse 8, the five angels bearing slaughtering weapons in their hands, they were already slaying before the angel reported to Jesus Christ. Now this is the question. Does verse 8, when the angels were already slaying, does the 144,000 at that time are already sealed? Brothers and sisters, now here's another statement in track number 1. Let's read pages 38 and page 39. And let us read the quotation. Ezekiel 9, verse 8, 9 and 10. And it came to pass, while they were slaying them, and I was left, that I fell upon my face and cried and said, Ah, Lord God, wilt thou destroy all the residue of Israel in thy pouring out of thy fury upon Jerusalem? Then said he unto me, The iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceedingly great, and as for me also, mine eye shall not spare, neither will I have pity. And it says, a commentary given by the Shepherd's Rod, after the sighing and crying ones were marked, which is not to be understood as being consummated in its entirety worldwide, before the slaying follows anywhere. It says, the slaughter completed and the matter reported. The Lord spake unto the man clothed with linen and said, Go in between the wheels, even under the cherub, and fill thine hand with coals of fire from between the cherubims and scatter them over the city. Ezekiel 10 verse 2. The scattering of the coals of fire over the city represents absolute purification of the heart. Gospel Workers page 23. Effected by the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon those who received the mark, those who escaped the slaughter. Following the completion of the slaughter, and just preceding the scattering of the coals of fire over the city, the cherubim stood on the right side of the house, and the cloud filled the inner court. Ezekiel 10 verse 2 and 3. Later, they lifted up their wings and mounted up from the earth in my sight, says the prophet. Ezekiel 10 verse 19. Then subsequently, he saw them again lift up their wings. Ezekiel 11 verse 22-23. Showing that though they had departed after the separation took place, Ezekiel 10 verse 3 and 19, they had later returned and were now departing for the second time. Now, this reading is easy to discern that they visited twice the earth because they departed twice. Now, let us connect another statement in track number 3. But before reading track number 3, and then we'll go back to this reading. In Ezekiel chapter 9, it is very plain. Let us read. Ezekiel 9 verse 4. And the Lord said unto him, Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. So that is the divine command given by God to the man with the writer ink horn by his side, to mark the righteous. Then verse 5, And to the others he said in mine hearing, Go ye after him through the city and smite, let not your eyes spare, neither have ye pity. Now verse 5 says, And to the others he said in mine hearing, Go ye after him, meaning they followed the man with the writer ink horn by his side. And that is the reason why the shepherd's rod says that the five men, let's go back again. In 1 SR page 37, it says, Five men followed the one. Or in other words, the five men bearing slaughtering weapons in their hands, they did not wait the angel with the writing ink horn by his side to report to Jesus, brothers and sisters, before they will slaughter the wicked. According to the shepherd's rod, as also stated in the Bible, that when Jesus Christ commanded the man with the writer ink horn by his side to seal the righteous, to place a mark in the forehead of the righteous, then immediately Jesus Christ commanded the five angels to follow after him. Now, I would like to ask again the question, when does the five angels follow the man with the writer ink horn? Is it immediately after the man with the writer ink horn completely sealed the 144,000? Then they did not wait that the man with the writer ink horn will return to Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ immediately commanded them, go ye after him. And then they began slaying even before the man with the writing ink horn had reported to Jesus Christ. Of course, there must be only one absolute answer, either one of the two. Either the five angels were already slaying while the man with the writer ink horn, his work in sealing the 144,000 are still unfinished. Or whether the five angels with slaughtering weapons, they began slaying the wicked immediately after the man with the writing ink horn completely finished his work in sealing the 144,000, but before he had been able to return to Jesus Christ to report the matter, the five angels were already slaying. So either one of that two must be the absolute answer. But the absolute fact is that the shepherd's rod is made it so plain that the five angels bearing slaughtering weapons in their hands were already slaying even before, brothers and sisters, the man with the writer ink horn reported to Jesus Christ. Now, for sure, that is the slaughtering by which the reason that only five angels are slaying at that time, because the man with the writer ink horn will go back to Jesus Christ and report to Jesus Christ. Or in other words, at the time when the five angels were slaying, the man with the writer ink horn is returning to Jesus to report the matter that he already completed. And that is the reason that he could not be a part of that slaying. There must only be five angels that slaying in that period of time. But we should not set aside the statement given by the shepherd's rod in tract number 3, page 71, that there is a slaughtering, that the man with the writer ink horn by his side is also performing the slaying. Why is it that in that slaying, all of them, the six angels, are performing the slaying? What period of time? Indicating that in that slaying, the man with the writer ink horn is not engaging in sealing the righteous, because he is engaging in slaying. Or in other words, the only tenable conclusion, brothers and sisters, is that there is a slaughtering by which the man with the writer ink horn by his side did not participate, only the five angels. But there is a slaying, there is a slaughtering by which the man with the writer ink horn is participating. And that is why six men, including the man with the writer ink horn, are slaying at that time. And we need now to study closely which will come first. And concerning the slaying of the five angels, five slaughtering angels, brothers and sisters, is there only one period of time by which the five slaughtering angels are slaying? Now, let us read 1SR Packet Edition. Here in 1SR Packet Edition, on page 55 and page 56, it says, the Passover too, in which perished all the firstborn of men and beasts that were found in the dwellings which had not the blood on the doorpost, forespoke an antitypical Passover in which all who are left without the mark because of not sighing and crying for the abominations in their midst will surely fall under the slaughter weapons of the angels. Ezekiel 9, verse 2. It did not say here how many angels that will slay. And let us continue. It says, when will this come to pass? The type unquestionably reveals the time through the fact that only the firstborn were then in danger. Only the firstborn were then in danger in that slaughtering. For sure, it could not be the slaughtering mentioned in Ezekiel 9, verse 6. Let's read Ezekiel 9, verse 6. It says, slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. Ezekiel 9, verse 6. So the slaughtering mentioned in Ezekiel 9, verse 6, the reason that it is called by inspiration in 1 TJ 52:21 and volume 3 to 67, general destruction of all the wicked Sabbath keepers, can be easily understood that such slaying, brothers and sisters, is not referring alone to the firstborn sons. But if there is a slaughtering by which all the firstborn sons will be the only one that will be in danger in that slaughtering, then the firstborn sons will perish first before all others. Now let us read 2 SR. I would like to read first 1 SR on page 96. It is entitled, Death of Firstborn. The firstborn, a symbol of a class of priesthood. A representation of Ezekiel 9 verse 6. Last part, the ancient men that were before the house, from the firstborn that seated upon the throne to the firstborn in the dungeon. Symbol of Ezekiel 9 verse 6. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. The firstborn of cattle, symbol of Isaiah 63 verse 18, Isaiah 64 verse 1, and Numbers 26 verse 10. Now there are three prophetic verses given here. Although Numbers 26 verse 10, let us read. It says here, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up together with Korah. When that company died, what time the fire devoured 250 men, and they became a sign. Numbers 26 verse 10. So Numbers 26 verse 10 is pointing to that typical event when the earth opened her mouth and swallowed, brothers and sisters, Korah, Datam, and Abiram. Now how about Isaiah 64 verse 1? Let us read. Isaiah 64 verse 1. Oh, that thou wouldest rend the heavens, and that thou wouldest come down, that the mountains might flow down at thy presence. And then Isaiah 63 verse 18, it says, thy people of thy holiness have possessed it but a little while. Our adversaries have trodden down thy sanctuary. So, I would like to read again. It says, the firstborn of cattle, symbol of Isaiah 63 verse 18. So, what is Isaiah 63 verse 18? Those who have polluted the sanctuary. And how about Isaiah 64, brothers and sisters? Now, to repeat again, the statement here is plainly telling us that the firstborn represent the class of priesthood. The class of priesthood, brothers and sisters. Now let us read 2 SR 169. It says here, does the noun men used by Ezekiel and the noun virgins by John is a collective biblical term comprehending both? Furthermore, the denomination numbers a little over 300,000 at the present time. Only about a third of them are men. If every man was sealed and numbered as one of the 144,000, we still would be far short of reaching the total. Again, we note, at the time of the Passover in Egypt, the blood on the doorpost was a type of the marking or sealing. So, that is very plain, brothers and sisters. Let us distinctly separate that occurrence, brothers and sisters, placing blood on the doorpost, that is pointing to the marking or sealing of the 144,000. Then it says, in that night, wherever the bloods appeared on the doorpost, the firstborn, whether male or female, perish not. Just so now, those who receive the seal have applied the blood on the doorpost forehead. And as the firstborn of both classes, those who died and those who did not were a type of the present priesthood ministry. Evidently, the type points forward to a ministry in the antitype, made up of both sexes. The firstborn who died represent the class that shall fall under the slaughter weapons of the five men. And the firstborn who escaped from death represent the class that shall receive the mark of the man with the writer's inkhorn and pass from death to life. Thus the firstborn who live and pass through the Red Sea are type of the 144,000. The first fruits of the harvest are the servants of God in the time of the loud cry of the third angel's message. Now, ponder deeply, brothers and sisters, this very important prophecy. Here, the voice of inspiration says that the firstborn represent ministry that shall fall under the slaughter weapons of the five men. I would like to go back again the Bible. Remember, brothers and sisters, the shepherd says that we need to, how that person says, I would like to read again, 2 SR page 18, that statement. Let's read. It says, one of the chief reasons why confusion arises among Bible students is because they do not entirely depend on the biblical expression of the words. They think themselves wiser than the prophets who were inspired with the Spirit of God, and thus wish to correct the words and meaning of the Holy Bible. Hence, finite mortals have attempted to rectify and correct the infinite one, whose wisdom, power, and vision is unsearchable. Though they know their interpretation of a text is not altogether in harmony with the whole tenor of the book and law, they see no injury and fear not God. And when the fact is revealed, they refuse to exchange error for truth because it contradicts their false theology. We invite the earnest attention of the reader upon this subject, and that he take notice of the wonderful harmony of the scriptures and the great wisdom used in them. But let us apply the statement subject, the subject of Ezekiel 9. I remember B.T. Hotep says, I think that is in 2 TG number 20, page 26. And it is Ezekiel 9, verse 4, 5, and 6. But I would like to read only the commentary. 2 TG 20, page 25. When the day approaches for this scripture to be fulfilled, this reading plainly indicating in reality the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, verse 4, 5, and 6, it was still future in the days of B.T. Hotep, because the 144,000 living saints were not yet in existence in his lifetime. Because if you will say that the 144,000 living saints are already in existence in 1930, even if the youngest of them is only 1 year old, today he must be 90 years old. How about if he is 5 years old at that time? Today, he must be 95 years old. We need to face the reality. But this statement can be easily understood saying, let's read 2 TG number 20, page 26. When the day approaches for this scripture to be fulfilled, so inscribing it in a future tense, then its truth must be the meat in due season for the people at that time. Nothing else can take its place. And so we see that as Nineveh was spared by the message to it, so the Laodiceans can only be saved by the message to the Laodiceans. 2 TG 20:26. Now, I think it is a part of the present truth today, Ezekiel chapter 9, because we are now on the very year by which the angel will seal the 144,000 living saints. Brothers and sisters, so let us read again the statement here in the Bible. It says, Ezekiel chapter 9 on verse 8, and it came to pass while they were slaying them, and I was left, that I fell upon my face. It says, and cried and said, Ah, Lord God, wilt thou destroy all the residue of Israel in thy pouring out of thy fury upon Jerusalem? Then said he unto me, the iniquity of the house of Israel and the house of Judah is exceeding great, and the land is full of blood, and the city full of perverseness. For they say, the Lord hath forsaken the earth, and the Lord seeth not. Now, in this vision, brothers and sisters, what would you think? Is there any that had been left when the angel is slaying, brothers and sisters? Now, to get the full beam of light, we need now to harmonize all the illustration given in the shepherd's rod. Now remember, one of the examples given by the shepherd's rod is the destruction of Korah, Datam, and Abiram. Now let us read 2 TG 24:24. It says, finally, what could be the dragon's flood that proceeds out of his mouth, if not dragon-prompted interpreters of the scriptures, through whom he expects to cause the church to be carried away? Who are they, the dragon's flood? They were the dragon-prompted interpreters of the scriptures. So the dragon's flood, they were not ordinary men, because they were the one who are interpreting the scriptures to the people. And then it says, truly the self-appointed prophets in Israel of today are more in number than were the prophets in Elijah's day. What does it mean, self-appointed prophets? Brothers and sisters, if you are teaching prophecy, by which in reality, God did not put His Spirit upon you to engage such work, then that is private. You are interpreting the prophecy in your own initiative. Then that is self-appointed. You are the one who appoint yourself. The statement in 2 TG 34, page 23, it says, And while you may choose to keep the Sabbath commandment, or in other words, B.T. Hotep says that you can voluntarily obey the commandments, but you cannot inspire yourself with the spirit of prophecy. You cannot voluntarily inspire yourself. That is a gift. It says, this gift is bestowed upon the remnant by God Himself. It is the absolute prerogative of God, unto whom He will bestow the gift. And this reading, brothers and sisters, I think is even more definitely applied today, while the angel with the writer inkhorn are still on his way to seal the 144,000 living saints. Brothers and sisters, as we continue this study, we will prove to you that the sealing angel did not as yet commence his work at this present time. Because there is a period of time of the sealing message which is pointing to the present truth, brothers and sisters. And that is consists of 1 year. I would like to read this reading. All the diagrams and the time chart we will show to you at the very end of our episodes. It says here in 2TG 44:48, when this thorough reformation takes place, then the cleansing fountain shall be opened to the whole house of David. Who are they, the whole house of David? The 144,000. To those who will be a part of that special company, they are the one who constitute the whole house of David. I would like to read to you old symbolic code. 3, symbolic code number 2, page 3. And now in the time of the ingathering of modern Israel, the 144,000 who are to make up the antitypical house of David. 3, symbolic code number 2, page 3. I would like to read again. And now in the time of the ingathering of modern Israel, the 144,000 who are to make up the antitypical house of David. So, the antitypical house of David, the entire constituent is the 144,000 living saints. And this cleansing fountain is intended to all of them. Now, let us say it again, 2TG 44:48. When this thorough reformation takes place, then the cleansing fountain shall be opened to the whole house of David. In that day, the wicked shall be cut off and keep out of the house of David, and the false teachers, prophets. Who are they, the false teachers here? Prophets, teachers of prophecy, shall feel ashamed of having ever thought their private interpretation of the scriptures. But that is the time, brothers and sisters, by which God put them into an open shame. That is why the admonition given in 1TG number 13, on page 7, it says, as inspiration unroots the scroll, it is, of course, but to be expected that it will find us surprisingly ignorant of many things, the very reason that it unrolls. If we therefore fail to exchange our ideas for the Lord, then what hope is there for us ever to become enlightened and fitted for eternity? Our ideas are to fall flat, and the Lord's prophecies are to stand high and lifted up. And then it says, our duty is to prove God's word correct, rather than to hold tenaciously to our preconceptions and misconceptions until God Himself steps in and put us to shame. We should not wait that time that God will steps in and put us to shame. It is high time now, brothers and sisters, to humble ourselves and bow down to the Lord. And it says, brothers and sisters, 2TG 44:48, then shall men fully realize. It is high time now to fully realize that though they could be taught by men to keep cattle, yet no man could teach them to prophesy, that this office is restricted to the spirit of prophecy, that no prophecy of the scriptures is of private interpretation. That is very plain, brothers and sisters. We need now to completely realize, because if we are not appointed by God, we are the only one who place ourselves into that office, the office of the prophecy, engaging interpretation of the prophetic events, while in reality, we are not called by God. Brothers and sisters, we will not be profited. We will only bring damnation to our own selves. And it is high time now to fully realize that each of us can voluntarily teach the commandments, to be teachers of the commandments of the Lord. But to teach the prophecy, that office is restricted to the Spirit of Christ. And it is the absolute prerogative of Jesus Christ unto whom he will bestow his spirit. Brothers and sisters, and that is a gift. Now let us go back again to our study. The only way that we could understand this important prophecy, brothers and sisters, is that let us now harmonize all other related statements. But brothers and sisters, the type is still God's searchlight, which unmistakably picture the event, brothers and sisters. Now let me read to you here in 3 symbolic code 8 to 10 page 9. Question number 178. It says, what like and how far? What will the slaughter in the churches be like? Will it involve the outside world? Answer. The slaughter of Ezekiel 9 is the antitype of the Passover in Egypt, and therefore it will be like it. Read Exodus chapter 12. In the antitype, the slaughter falls first in the church, Testimonies for the Church, volume 5, page 211, and later in the world, the Great Controversy, 656. Hence, it is in two sections, one before the final close of provision and one after. Now, we have already find the answer here in 3 symbolic code 8 to 10, page 9, in our diagram. The close of provision there, it is answered here, final close of provision. Now, let us now place, what close of provision? The answer is final close of provision. The answer is 3 symbolic code 8 to 10, page 9. Because the quotation we read, there is no statement what provision. In 3 symbolic code number 1, page 9, it just say close of provision. So let us place 3 symbolic code number 1, page 8 in the word close of provision. But the answer is 3 symbolic code 8 to 10, page 9. Final close of provision. Final close of provision. And of course, final close of provision to all Sabbath keepers. Now let us now focus our attention here in 3 symbolic code number 8 to 10 page 9, because we have a picture. The slaughtering in Exodus chapter 12. The slaughtering in Exodus chapter 12. What is the slaughtering in Exodus chapter 12? Now, brethren, the shepherd's rod commanded us, read Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12, I think, how many verses? Let me read to you. Exodus chapter 12, it has 51 verses. So you can read the entire chapter at your own leisure, brothers and sisters. But we will read only those portions by which it is very important. I would like to read Exodus chapter 12, verse 30, a beginning from verse 29. And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne, unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. Verse 30. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. So remember, in verse 30 it says, Pharaoh and all the parents, they did not see how their firstborn died. Because at the time when they woke up, it says, and Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. Remember, all. There was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. All the houses, there was dead. Now the shepherd says, it will be like it. What is the command? What is the command by God to the angel in Ezekiel chapter 9? We need to study the Bible now and then connect the explanation given by the shepherd's rod. It says, Ezekiel 9 verse 6, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark. And the shepherd's rod says, the slaughtering in Ezekiel 9 is the same with the slaughtering in Egypt. It will be like it. Now this is the question. If it is like the slaughtering in Egypt, does the death angel enter the house by which there is a blood on the doorpost? They did not enter. Now what is the representation of the house, brothers and sisters? Is it not the movement? The voice of inspiration says, represent the ministry. The ministry represents the movement. Now, think it thoroughly, brothers and sisters. If you are in the movement by which there is no present truth in that movement, then there is no blood on the doorpost. Then the angel can can enter into that movement. I remember the statement here in 1SR on page 98 and page 99. It says, the blood on the doorpost is the symbol of the seal. Revelation 7. Mark Ezekiel 9. Revelation 7 and Ezekiel 9 is the same mark or seal. See Testimonies to Ministers, page 445. The blood being applied on the doorpost is to signify that the seal or mark by which the 144,000 are to be sealed is to be visible. It is visible, brothers and sisters. The doorpost and the forehead both have the same significance. We do not mean to say that it is a certain visible brand or mark on their foreheads, but a seal of character, principle, or rule. The standard being the pure word of God. Thus, they apply the blood on the doorpost, and their brethren in the church could be conscious of a change. What will change? Present truth. Let us read 2SR, page 198. The present truth has a power to change the individual. Now let us read 2SR, page 198. The present truth has the power to change the individual and fit him for eternal life, which is the seal of the living God. Say Jesus, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. John 3, verse 5. So the statement that the sign that we applied the doorpost, the blood on the doorpost, we place blood on the doorpost, indicates that such people are conscious of a change. What will change us? Present truth. So they are already conscious, they are already eager to know and to understand the present truth. The true people of God will be awakened to their poverty. 2 TJ 24:23. What poverty? Spiritual poverty, that there was no meat in due season in their midst. Let us read again 2 TJ 24:23. It says, the church therefore will not sleep forever. The true people of God will awake to their poverty. They will profit at this rousing call, but the dragon's blood will fill the bowels of the earth. Now ponder deeply. Brethren, I would like to read to you this verse in Exodus chapter 12. It says here, by which the Bible made it so plain. Now let us go back again, brothers and sisters, to our subject. I would like to repeat again, Exodus chapter 12, verse 30. It says, and Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. And what house, brothers and sisters, by which there was no dead? Only the house by which there is a blood in the doorpost, brothers and sisters. And accordingly, the blood on the doorpost represent the present truth. Or only, brethren, the movement by which there is a present truth in their midst will then be spared. Now let me read to you 1 TJ 31, page 9. It says, the firstborn, firstfruits who failed to paint the doorpost with a sacrificial blood in the first Exodus, the type, perish. So any of the firstfruits of today who fails to comply with the demands of the message for today will as certainly perish at the angels' slaughter weapons. Now I would like to read again. It says, so any of the first fruits of today, the shepherd's rod is not saying that there is 144,000 that will be slain, brothers and sisters. But the shepherd's rod is telling to all brothers and sisters, the ministry, whether it be the Bidian or to all the 12 tribes of today who fails to comply with the demands of the message for today. What is the demands of the message for today? Of course, you need to accept the present truth. If your movement do not have the present truth, then accept the present truth. That is the only way that you could preserve your life. Brothers and sisters, we need to accept the present truth. Now, here's another statement that I would like to read in 2SR page 217. It says here, they who are to be sealed at that time were seen by John as a great multitude with palms in their hands. See Revelation 7 verse 9. Hence the scroll has made a turn, and the sealing for those who shall be judged while living has begun. Now, Bitihotep is not saying that the sealing of those who will be judged while living began in 1930 or in his lifetime. Now, let us study closely this statement so that we could understand, brothers and sisters. Let's read again. It says, they who are to be sealed at that time were seen by John as a great multitude with palms in their hands. Hence, the scroll has made a turn, meaning the unrolling of the scroll. And that unrolling of the scroll, that is the fulfillment in the vision of Sister White as quoted by B.T. Hotep in Answerer number 2, page 68. Let us read. Viewing the question in the light of both statements, we see that Christ leaves the sanctuary at a certain time in the unrolling of the scroll. So Jesus Christ leaves the heavenly sanctuary at a certain time at the unrolling of the scroll. Coming to the church, he finds her not spotless and ready to meet him, but deep in sin, yet self-complacently feeding upon the errors, faults, and mistakes of others. And the thing which is very sad, because this attitude is found among professed Shepherd's Rod believers. They profess to be a Shepherd's Rod believers, but they were ruining the reputation of other people, backbiting, character assassination, feeding the faults of other people, spreading, advertising the mistakes and errors of other people. They were only fulfilling the prophecy, brothers and sisters. Now here's another statement in tract number 1 on page 24. These solemn words may it lay well to heart, and may none let the enemy beguile them with good words and fair speeches on this life and death matter. Fix in your mind the fact that Christ rising up from his mediatorial work cannot be after probation has closed. For note carefully, he is to rise up during the unfolding of truth. Let it take heed that he fail not to criticize the message or the messengers, but rather that he sigh and cry as the Lord bids for all the abominations that be done in the midst the church, lest he be found on the wrong side, reigns with the evildoers, and thus doomed to fall under the angel's slaughter weapons. Tract number 1 on page 24. Now let's go back to SR page 217. It says, hence the scroll has made a turn, and the sealing for those who shall be judged while living has begun. To repeat again, it cannot be construed that in 1930 or in the lifetime of B.T. Hotep, the sealing, or it says the sealing of those people who are being judged while living has begun in his days. Because he himself is very plain telling us here in 2SR page 162, it says, the cases of all who are sealed from 1929 to the final close of probation will be investigated before the throne in the heavenly sanctuary while living. The investigation commences after the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. Those who are sealed from 1929 to the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, close of probation for the church, are living saints, 144,000 in number, who shall never die, translated without tasting death. You see, brothers and sisters, when would be the judgment or the investigation of those who will be judged while living? It is after the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9. And what is the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9? The sealing of the 144,000. And after the fulfillment of Ezekiel 9, meaning close of provision for the church. So it cannot be applied in the days of B.T. Hotep. The judgment to the people who are destined to die and they were judged while living began in his days. Otherwise, we'll be saying that the 144,000 completely sealed in 1930 or in the lifetime of B.T. Hotep and probation closed. Because that is not the reality. This is a prophecy. B.T. Hotep is plainly telling here that during the time when the unfolding of the truth or the unrolling of the scroll, that is the time by which those who will be judged while living will begin. And it says, as we stated before, the Passover night in Egypt is a type of the purification of the church, separating the tares from the wheat. The crossing of the Red Sea by the Israelites pointed forward to the fulfillment of Isaiah 63. Now remember, we have now Isaiah 63, Isaiah 64, and Numbers 26, verse 10. Now, we already read in 2TG. Let us go back again in 2TG 24:24. The dragon's blood, the prompted interpreters of the scriptures, brothers and sisters, brethren, we will not condemn by God, even though we engage in private interpretation. At the moment, we repent, but we will be condemned because we persistently continue. interpretation, even at the time when we are being warned, brothers and sisters, of such evil work. And I think that statement in 1 TG, let me read to you. I think it is pointing to the people by which I would like to read this statement in 1 TG 18, page 15 and 16. The name of the idols, the flattering titles of men, shall forever be forgotten, brothers and sisters. Flattering titles. Well, I would like to apply that also to myself. The word flattering meaning I'm only fooling my own self. For example, if I will say that I am antitypical David, I am antitypical Elijah the Tisbite, while in reality, it is a lie. I am only flattering myself. That is a flattering title. Now, even though that if I'm not the one who called myself in that title, for example, the people, the congregation will tell, you are antitypical David. You are antitypical Elijah. While in reality, it is not true. Then that is a flattering title. We need to be honest in our profession, brothers and sisters. The boundary line becoming shorter and shorter. There is one that I could rest assured to you that on that date, there is a midnight slaughtering. Although what I am trying to study now, if that slaughtering, is it the first or is it the last? And that would be on September 22, 2022. We are now 2020. Now, I would like to read to you this reading in 1 TG, number 18, page 15 and 16. The names of the idols, the flattering titles of men, shall forever be forgotten in that day. Thereafter, neither a false prophet nor an unclean spirit shall be tolerated in the land. In fact, not even a father or a mother will then tolerate their own son to pose as such, but they shall deliver him to the executioners. It shall come to pass that the men who are now exalting themselves and preaching without being sent, you see, preaching without having been sent, shall be ashamed as their eyes come wide open when caught in their fallacies, in false predictions, and private interpretations of the scriptures, no longer wear deceitful garments. Rather, they will say, I am no prophet, not even a pastor. I am only a herdsman, a common farmer. 1 TG number 18, page 15 and page 16. Although I do not know if that illustration, the one who confesses, is it probationary time or is it already at the time when everything is too late? Now, I would like to read 2 TG 24, page 24. Truly, the self-appointed prophets in Israel of today are more in number than were the prophets in Elijah's day. Here is a fact which only deep and blind persons would try to deny. No, I am not taking pleasure in unveiling this truth. I do it only because I must. God wants his people to have the truth, and so I have no alternative but to tell it. This flood against which the ever-living church is struggling to make headway is, we are told, to be swallowed by the earth. It is to be done away with as were the self-appointed prophets in Moses' day. Namely, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, princes of the assembly, famous in the congregation, men of renown. Number 16, verse 2. These and all their followers and sympathizers perish. The earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up and their houses. And all the men that appertained unto Korah and all their goods. Now the shepherds had quoted that it will be like it. We have two examples. The slaughtering in Egypt and the occurrence in the days of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. Are they pointing to the same event? Because in the type, that is different events. Brothers and sisters, now remember the Bible says their houses, and let us go back again to the statement in 2 TG 24:24. These and all their followers and sympathizers perish. The sympathizers, they are not followers. They are only sympathizers. But both the followers and sympathizers perish. Now, brothers and sisters, the Bible is very plain. Let us read Numbers 16, verse 21. Separate yourselves from among this congregation, that I may consume them in a moment. Verse 26. And he spake unto the congregation, saying, Depart, I pray you, from the tents of these wicked men, and touch nothing of theirs, lest ye be consumed in all their sins. There are two words used by inspiration here. Separate and depart. It's up to you how you interpret that words. But the Bible is very plain. It says, separate yourselves among this congregation. Who are they? The self-appointed leadership. Brothers and sisters, self-appointed leadership. Brothers and sisters, it is very important, brothers and sisters, that at this time, we need to study closely and ponder deeply what the Bible teaches as interpreted by the shepherd's rod. The Bible is very plain that before the earth opened her mouth, there is a divine command given by God to separate yourselves, depart, separate from what? To such movement by which the present truth cannot be found in that movement, brothers and sisters. The only movement that the voice of inspiration recommends us to join must be the movement where the present truth can be found. That is the only movement, brethren. And then, in order for us to ascertain clearly, then we need now to study what is the present truth for today. Now, let us go back to our subject concerning the slaughtering or the destruction. I would like to read this reading in the Old Symbolic Code. Let me read to you. Here in the Old Symbolic Code, 1 Symbolic Code, number 14, page 6. I would like to repeat again, brothers and sisters. God's true movement cannot be recognized by name in reality. That is not the safe way to determine that that is God's true movement. Because, for example, if you are in the days of Sister White, what would you think? If you will base your choice by name, you might join the Church of God because there are many verses in the Bible. They will read, oh, this is the Church of God. God's movement must be the Church of God. And some call their movement Church of Christ. This is the true movement because according to the Bible, the true movement is the Church of Christ, the Church of the Holy Ghost. But the shepherd's rod made it so plain that the only true church of God in 1844 is the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And it is not recognized by name, but rather by the present truth that had been bestowed by God into that movement. That the true church of God is the Seventh-day Adventist. The true church of Christ, it is the Seventh-day Adventist. The true church of the Holy Ghost, it is the Seventh-day Adventist. Although the Seventh-day Adventist Church were not called by that name, but that is the reality. Now, I would like to read this reading in 1 Symbolic Code, number 14, page 6. It says, as Amos says, the habitations of the shepherd shall mourn. It is obvious that Amos' prophecy is yet future, for the word habitations, places, is in plural form, which cannot be applied to one shepherd's habitation, denomination, but to all that be in existence at that time. The term shepherds means, as understood, the same as the ancient men which were before the house, the ministers. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 211. Note that the shepherds are not themselves to mourn, but their habitations, their houses, that is the membership of their churches, which fact reveals that it will be thus at the time when the sleeping multitudes in the churches awake from their spiritual insensibility and find that the shepherds whom they have implicitly trusted for their salvation had deceived all those who follow them. It's hard to imagine the statement, implicitly trusted for their salvation. Now this is the question, why is it that in this prophecy, it is not the shepherds that shall mourn, but the membership? How about in Isaiah? Let's read Isaiah chapter 3 on verse 26. And her gates shall lament and mourn, and she being desolate shall sit upon the ground. So let us read the commentary given by the shepherd's rod. First, I would like to read 1 TG number 6, 32 to 33. The very thing that sifts out the unconverted because the standard of her profession is cast to the winds, her gates of gathering places shall lament and mourn. Desolate shall sit on the ground, not on a throne. Why suffer such a loss? Now, I would like to read 1 SR 140 and in the symbolic code. Here in 1 SR page 140, it says, the gates of a house serve the purpose to let in those who have the right and to keep out all others. This could have no other meaning than the watchmen on the walls of Zion, the ministry. I would like to read again. The gates of a house serve the purpose to let in those who have the right and to keep out all others. This could have no other meaning than the watchmen on the walls of Zion, the ministry. Therefore, the gates represent ministry. Now, here in the symbolic code, the same. Let me see if we find that statement. Saying, the gates shall lament and mourn. 12 symbolic code, number 6 and 7, page 13. Since gates are not able to lament and mourn, they must represent people. Those who let others come in and go out. So the same in 1 SR 140. Therefore, they must be represent watchmen, ministers. This verse says, they shall lament and mourn. Beside this sad state of affairs, Zion is described as being desolate. If she at that time is desolate, it would mean that she is empty, empty of sinners and sin. All of this, you see, brings us to the time of the purification, which comes also in a time of war. In that day, the gates will lament and mourn. 12 symbolic code, 6 and 7, page 13. So, this description in Isaiah 3, verse 26 is opposite to the description in Amos chapter 1. Because it is the ministry that will lament and mourn. Whereas in the prophecy in Amos, it is the membership that will lament and mourn. It can be easily understood, brothers and sisters. Who cried out on that midnight slaughtering? Pharaoh. It is Pharaoh. Pharaoh cried out. Now let us go back to the Bible again. If the shepherd says, it will be like it. Now let's read Exodus on chapter 12, verse 29 and 30. And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne, unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants, and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. Now who is antitypical Pharaoh? The shepherds are very plain, that is the leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. 1 SR page 77. Another Pharaoh arose. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. Exodus 1 verse 8. If the first Pharaoh who exalted Joseph, which is Jesus Christ, represented the leadership in the days of the apostles, then this new Pharaoh must represent the leadership of this present movement at the time this subject became known. Note, this new Pharaoh knew not Joseph. The meaning is that the leadership of this organization have left following their master, Jesus Christ. I think all the vision will agree that the Pharaoh mentioned here is the leadership in the Seventh-day Adventist Church General Conference. Now here's another statement in 106 in 1 SR, 106 and 107. If the first Pharaoh makes a perfect type of the church leadership in the days of the apostles, then we must accept the last Pharaoh who knows not Joseph as a perfect type of the church leadership who have turned from following Christ the leader, their leader. Volume 5, page 217. So these two passages, all of us can easily discern that the antitypical Pharaoh is the leadership in the General Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And they must be represented by the ministry that lament and mourn. Why? Because all their firstborn sons were destroyed. Who are the firstborn sons? The ministry. Or in other words, the firstborn sons must be pointing brothers and sisters under leadership of Pharaoh. Those people who are in the ministry, but under the leadership of Pharaoh, under the leadership of the General Conference, Seventh-day Adventist Church. And the reason that they will lament and mourn the antitypical Pharaoh, because those ministers under their leadership had been destroyed. But how about Amos chapter 1? Why is it that the membership are the one who lament and mourn? And who are they? So the description in Amos chapter 1 can be easily discerned that it is the ministry that had been destroyed. It is the leadership. The leadership first had been destroyed before the membership. Although in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the one that had been destroyed is also the leadership, but under leadership of Pharaoh. As the type teaches, that when Pharaoh woke up in the night, all the firstborn sons under his dominion, all the firstborn sons under his dominion, all of them were dead. And Pharaoh cried out, lament and mourn.
So in the antitype, there must be a group of people, brothers and sisters, and most assuredly pointing to the Seventh-day Adventist Church leadership, the jail conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. The statement, Pharaoh and all his servants, meaning the servants mentioned there in Exodus 12 verse 30, are those who are in the general conference. The president of the general conference and all the constituent of that leadership, they will lament and mourn because all their pastors under their leadership had been destroyed. Brothers and sisters, but not the same with that vision in Amos chapter 1, because it is the membership that lament and mourn, plainly indicating, brothers and sisters, their leadership, or what happened to their leadership. Why is it that they lament and mourn? Now, I would like to read again the Bible in Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 7. And he said unto them, defile the house and fill the courts with the slain. Go ye forth. And they went forth and slew in the city. Defile the house and fill the courts with the slain. And for sure, it could not be the same with the description recorded in Luke. Right, brothers and sisters? Now, let me read to you here in 2TG. 2TG number 41, page, is it page 21? Isaiah 8, verse 15. And many among them shall stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and be taken. According to this scripture, many of them will find the rapture not to their liking, and not according to their teaching of it. Now, this statement can be easily discerned that this group of people, they were teaching rapture. But the rapture that fulfilled in their lives is not to their liking and not according to their teaching of it. Isaiah 8 verse 15, 100% cannot be applied to the world, brothers and sisters. Now, let us read another statement in 1TG number 24, page 12. Let us read. It says, the title of God's people, you note, is Judah. They are counseled to behold the messenger of God, who at the fulfillment of this prophecy brings to them good tidings, tidings of peace, the message of the kingdom of peace. Isaiah 11 verse 6 to 9. The Lord counsels them to be honest with Him, honest in their profession of faith. I fully believe that the title Judah is pointing to the Shepherd's Rod believers, not to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Because the title of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is Israel, not Judah. Now, for example, I would like to read to you 1TG 43 on page 19. The people that are crying for deliverance are those whom Abraham did not know, whom Israel of today, the denomination, does not acknowledge. So it says, whom Israel of today, the denomination. So the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the title given by the Shepherd's Rod is Israel, not Judah. Here's another statement in 2TG, number 39, page 25. Plainly, the house of Judah, since 1930, stand in the same need as the house of Israel stood after 1890. So what is the house of Israel in 1890? That is the Seventh-day Adventist Church, because at that time, the Davidian is not yet in existence. But it says the house of Judah since 1930. So the house of Judah, for sure, that is the Davidian. Brothers and sisters, now I would like to read again here in at 1TG 24:12. The title of God's people, you note, is Judah. And there's another proof to prove that that title Judah is more definitely applied to us, the Davidian, rather than to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Here in 1TG, number 22, page 24. It is, I think, from Zephaniah 2, verse 3. Seek ye the Lord, all ye meek of the earth, which have brought his judgment. Seek righteousness, seek meekness. It may be ye shall be hid in the day of the Lord's anger. When this judgment-bound nation begins to gather together, it is, if never before, that the meek of the earth need to seek meekness. The meek of the earth are those who have wrought the Lord's judgment, who have proclaimed the message of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. They are His people, His church. 1 TG 22:24. And B.T. says, negatively stated, the Seventh-day Adventist Church never proclaimed the message of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And the only people that proclaim the great and dreadful day of the Lord, it is the Davidian, the Shepherd's Rod believers. Let us read 1 TG 24:12. The title of God's people, you note, is Judah. They are counseled to behold the messenger of God, who at the fulfillment of this prophecy brings to them good tidings, tidings of peace, the message of the kingdom of peace. Isaiah 11 verse 6 to 9. The Lord counsels them to be honest with Him, honest in their professions of faith. They are moreover assured that at the fulfillment of this prophecy, the destroying angels are to remove the wicked from the midst of the righteous. It says the wicked are to be removed. Thus will the wicked be raptured away and be no more. Brothers and sisters, the Bible is very plain concerning to the house of Israel or the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Defile the house, fill the house with slain body. Brothers and sisters, the word raptured meaning transferred to another place. And there is no other that can explain except that prophecy in Luke 17, right? Now let us read 11 Symbolico, number 12, page 17 and 18. It says, you cannot say that the judgment we are reading about in Matthew 25 is the judgment which is to take place during the millennium, because His people are not then among the nations. There is positively no escaping the conclusion that it takes place in the time of the judgment for the living, when both the righteous and the wicked are commingled on the earth. Since, moreover, this work of separation goes on among the people themselves, it is clear that it is not a work to be done in heaven, but it is a work to be done on the earth. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken and the other left. Matthew 24 verse 40 and 41. Some call that the rapture, but it is quite different than what they think it is. 11 Symbolico, number 12, 17 and 18. Now let us go to the Bible. Luke 17. Luke chapter 17 on verse 34 to verse 37. I tell you, in that night, there shall be two men in one bed. The one shall be taken and the other shall be left. Two women shall be grinding together. The one shall be taken and the other left. Two men shall be in the field. The one shall be taken and the other left. And they answered and said unto him, where, Lord? And he said unto them, wheresoever the body is, thither will the eagles be gathered together. Luke 17, verse 34 to verse 37. And every Davidian understood that the one that have been taken are the unsaved ones. They have been gathered into one place. And there, brothers and sisters, all of them will be destroyed, gathered into one place. And that is very plain, brothers and sisters. The statement here in 1 TJ 24:12, the destroying angels are to remove the wicked from the midst of the righteous. But it is pointing to Judah. We know the term Judah refers only to Judah and not to the 10 tribes. It says the destroying angels are to remove the wicked from the midst of the righteous. Thus will the wicked be raptured away and be no more. Now for example, concerning when the earth opened her mouth in the days of Korah, Datam, and Abiram, after the earth closed her mouth, did anybody see the dead bodies of those men? Nobody. But that is figurative. Unlike with the fulfillment in Ezekiel 9 verse 6, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the dead bodies, they could see, they could witness the dead bodies. The same as in the days of Pharaoh, they saw the dead bodies, but not with this destruction. Nobody knows. The shepherds had called it in 2 TJ number 16:21. I would like to read this reading. The dragon, though, is again to miss the mark, for the earth is to open her mouth and swallow up the blood, 2 TJ 16:21. That is, inspiration definitely forecasts that those who join the church for some purpose other than to follow and practice the truth shall be disposed of by a miracle, be swallowed by the earth as it were. 2 TJ 16:21. Miraculously, they will disappear. They have been raptured. Brothers and sisters, I remember the statement here in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1. It says, Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 131. I was shown the company present at the conference, said the angel, some food for worms, some subjects of the seven last plagues, some will be alive and remain upon the earth to be translated at the coming of Jesus. It says, some food for worms, brothers and sisters, and some are subjects of to the seven last plagues. It's pointing to the seven symbolical plagues. And in this study, we will enumerate to you one by one the destruction of all the wicked. First, the destruction of all the wicked Sabbath keepers. The destruction of all of them, brothers and sisters, that failed to receive the seal of the living God. You know, for me, that statement in 13 symbolic code 1 and 2, page 19. This verse is not describing the conditions that will prevail as a result of the coming of the brightness of the Lord when He comes in the clouds. This is a slaughter from the great whirlwind of verse 32. It is from war. Why should the Lord first bring this on Judah and Jerusalem and then to the nations? Because they have the greatest light and therefore the least reason to be wicked. Then when this war starts in the time of the deliverance of God's people, the most enlightened people will suffer first. And apology for me, the most enlightened people must be the obedient, brothers and sisters. And that is how God works, brothers and sisters, for sure. The one who will suffer first, supposed to be those people who have more light because they need to be the most least wicked because they have all the information according to the voice of inspiration. So on our next episode, brothers and sisters, we will try to segregate all the destruction, brothers and sisters, to all Sabbath keepers. There are only three classes of Sabbath keepers. Sabbath keepers under the banner of the third angel's message. Sabbath keepers, the literal Israel. And the Sabbath keepers, which is not under the banner of the third angel's message. And at the same time, they were not Israelites. These three, for sure, there must be righteous. And to repeat again, the very first constituent of the great multitude, which no man could number, are the undefiled ones. The one stated in track number 9, page 56, and track number 3, page 72. The undefiled ones. And the undefiled ones, they are the Sabbath keepers. They are the Sabbath keepers, brothers and sisters. So we'll continue that subject, brothers and sisters, and hoping that you will abide listening and viewing this program. May the good Lord bless you and have a wonderful evening.